Yo, you guys, this week's episode of Tokyo Ghoul. Stunning. I was shocked. I was genuinely shocked as to the direction where they took it. I didn't think that they would spend that much time on the mental aspect of Kaneki's situation. But they did. In fact, the vast majority of it is Kaneki's mental situation. The breaking down of his morals, of his values. From the simultaneous physical torture, the mental torture, and then Rize's own encouragement. And then when you start from the core of his values, his mom, and then you break those down. And then you go from his mom to Hide. Then you go from Hide to the mom of Hinami. And then you keep on going down. And then you go to future possibilities about Touka and Hinami dying and Hide dying. But before he does die, he calls him a monster. All this stuff. And you're like, all the while knowing that he's getting these red centipedes in his ear, and he's getting his feet and his hands ripped off every time Jason comes in there with the pliers. And let me start off from, because I want to talk about that more in detail. I want to go to the basics first. The only bad thing is, if you would, the story progression, where in which, in essence, we're just starting from the same spot we did last episode. Basically, it's just, we're backtracking and we're just getting Kaneki's view, like his entire view about what's going on with his situation. But we still end off where the previous episode ends off, same thing. And then we go to the animation. The animation was very good when it came to the mental scenes. And clearly there's a lot of symbolism there. When it came to the white and the red, it's very obvious, a lot of symbolism there. But it was fluid, it was very vibrant, given the environment, because it was like a dark room, and you know, like, normally Tokyo Ghoul, they have dark environments, so it's kind of hard to see sometimes, given those dark environments. But despite that, it was very vibrant, very colorful, it was dynamic yet smooth. And the only bad part is the censorship, as always. But it was a damn good fight. It was like, whoa! Kaneki was going ham! Like, you knew that he was... And it's not more so the ferocity, because he's not yelling or screaming. He's not bloodthirsty like he was. Like, every time Rize took over for, like, a split second, he'd be, like, bloodthirsty and yelling and going crazy. It's the cold-blooded ruthlessness while he's still maintaining 100% composure. Calm, cool, collected, sinister, cold-blooded, and ruthless. And he gets the job done easy. Like it's a walk in the park. It's a complete change, a complete 180 from when Rize first takes over and he just starts yelling and yeah, blood, yeah, I'm hungry. So that was very surprising, aside from the fact that he has now white hair. And I don't know if he can, like, interchange modes. Like, I don't, like, because this may be, like, a mode, or it's, like, the new Kaneki, so I'm not too sure. Because just how Jason had his personality changed completely, so, like, there's no indication that, the only indication that we have of Jason retaining some of his old self is towards the end of the episode, where in which Jason starts to cry once Kaneki starts to tell him, count from... subtract 7 from 1,000. So he's being tortured in the same fashion that he was a few, you know, years ago. And that those tears clearly represent the old Jason, Yomori, that was sealed away by Jason, if you would, the alter personality. So the original Kaneki is still somewhere in there, obviously. But whether or not this Kaneki with the YRS has taken over completely, not too sure. We're going to find out later on, obviously. Now, the main meat here. The psychological aspect of this episode, I think, is phenomenal. Well, okay, well, no. Before I get to that, the pacing So you have maybe like give or take 4 or 5 minutes of fight. And then the rest of it beforehand was all the psychological stuff, which was, again, fantastic. And then from a character standpoint, it's Kaneki. It's only Kaneki. Well, I didn't mention Yomori, Jason, at the end. And that one is, it's not as, you know, it's not as noticeable, obviously, but because it is very subtle, but it's there with the tears. But it's Kaneki. Kaneki has clearly the biggest leap in his character development by far, because now there's a new Kaneki, an alter ego, if you would. Rize, combined with his own ego, if you would. Because it's not just her, it's also him and her. But it's his new mindset. Because his old values have been, in a sense, not removed, but they've been diluted, they've been tainted. So let me get to that, okay? Now, the mental aspect is, I think, superb. At first, I'm watching this and I'm like, eh, like it's not that bad. And then as it slowly progresses forward, you're like, whoa. Then you're like, holy shit. Then you're like, whoa, like this is getting, it's getting pretty deep. So in essence, what it is, first of all, let me talk about the flowers. The flowers are obvious, okay? You have the white rose. I think it's a rose, whatever. You have a white flower, and then throughout the course of the episode, the white flower transforms into like a red flower. And the white flower represents his previous values that his mom gave him, obviously. And Rize represents his new set of values. So, in essence, it is the two most influential women in his life. Rize and his mom. Now, Rize not more so direct. Well, Rize, yeah, more direct, but not to his own, like, he wasn't aware of Rize's influence until he actually became a ghoul through means of the doctor. And by the way, the doctor actually, he did know. The doctor is a ghoul, and he did know that he was transplanting ghoul organs into Kaneki. Or at least he, okay, fine. Well, whether or not he's a ghoul or not, I don't think it's confirmed, but he did know that he was transplanting Rize's organs into Kaneki, and she was ghoul. He did know that. But the thing here is this. The white rose represents his set of values beforehand. And again, they transform into Rize's values, all right? So his mom, who died because she overworked herself, and that was confirmed, that was revealed in the episode. And she overworked herself because she had to pay off, give money to her sister, who had issues with money. So she had to work a lot of jobs, and she was always tired, always came back home late, didn't spend that much time with Kaneki. Kaneki wind up spending a lot of time in his dad's room, in his reading room. And then she wound up dying as a result of overworking herself. So he believed that the best thing for him was to retain her set of values. But Rize slowly force feeds this notion of throwing away her values given the current circumstances and given future possible circumstances involving Touka and Inami being killed, Anteku being wiped out, and then Hide saying you're a monster before he dies as well by the hands of Jason. And this all goes back to one key point, but I'll get to that later. The next thing I want to talk about when it comes to the flowers is the obvious fact that they represent the purity, and then they represent later on the corrupt nature of the world, if you would, of the ghoul system. And what you have basically is the white rose, the purity. That is, again, what he believes in, how you shouldn't hit anyone or you shouldn't hurt anyone, because when you hurt someone and when you kill someone, you take away their chances, you ruin their lives, stuff like that. And I mean, basically, don't do upon others what you wouldn't done to be done to you, something like that. I forgot what the exact quote went, but it's something on those lines. And what's fascinating is that this set of values that he believed in, he gets tested by from Jason's standpoint. But beforehand, remember how Kaneki fought against Amon, and he let Amon go. He pleaded with Amon, don't make me into a killer, because that would go against what he was taught by his mom. And what you have is the white rose, which is his purity, being corrupted by the cruelty of the world. That's the red flower. And Jason tests him in this notion as well by taking the two cats out there before, the girl and the ghoul, the girl and the guy, and he says, so I made them clean you up, and they said that they would save you. I mean, Banjo was there too, but, you know, Banjo, I don't know where he is now, whatever. He may be fighting against the doves, who knows. But Jason purposefully put them there so he could mentally attack Kaneki. And then, because he realized that Kaneki, from a physical standpoint, was phenomenal. He would regenerate at a very rapid rate. Something new that we found out. And, I mean, we see in the fight where this dude, I mean, that was an amazing scene where Jason grabs on and he's like, I'm not letting go. And he breaks his own leg into fucking like 720 spins. And he kicks him in the fucking face. And that shit recovers on the spot. He's like, yo, after all this shit you did to me, you thought that would hurt? Nah, you front. Like, I'm like, Kaneki, what the? That was beast. Oh, that was beast. Oh my God, that was beast. But let me go deeper into the whole, because the whole psychology there with Jason and killing, giving Kaneki a choice. I mean, he's just simply put breaking down the values. He's bringing down his moral code. And he basically says, you have to choose one or the other. And given Kaneki's position, he can't choose because he was not raised in this fashion by his mom. So he says, all right, fine. You ain't going to choose. I'm going to kill them both. He starts to slowly snap this girl's neck. And he's like, choose. You better do it. And the dude on the ground, he's like, please, I'm begging you, choose me, kill me. And Kaneki can't do it. He could not do it. And Jason wants to kill them both anyway. Now, this goes all back to one particular notion. It's simple, but it is the root of all this. Power. Now, in this day and age, power can be defined as many things. You're going to have power in money. You're going to have power in physique. You're going to have power in knowledge. You're going to have power in influence. You're going to have power in charisma. You're going to have power in all sorts of avenues. Power is not limited to just one thing in this day and age, obviously. It's actually very vast in many fields and many expertise of the world. And it will continue to grow as humanity itself grows, as we take upon the greatest journey of all to go into outer space and propagate and transverse the universe and so on and so forth. As when we know more, I mean, because that's power from a knowledge standpoint, but that also branches off because each power category has its own subcategories, but whatever. It's not important here. What's important here is power in and of itself. Power, in our real world standpoint, has many avenues. But when you go to their world, to their system, you realize that it's very primitive in what real power is. You see, Kaneki is a very smart person. He's very knowledgeable. He reads books all the time. And he's in college for something. I don't know exactly what. But the point here is that in this system, it's a very primitive notion of the weak die and the strong survive. And at the same time, it brings in a modern day notion of power and justice. Because Kaneki is always about justice. He's always about doing the right thing. But he has no power to back up his justice. You see, power without justice is meaningless. And I mean, I don't want to bring another series here, but there's another series. There's another character. His first name begins with an M, last name begins with U, who pretty much had the same notion, where power without justice, I'm sorry, justice without power is meaningless, but power without justice is, I want to say cruelty, or it's savagery, or it's just plain malicious. So there has to be justice within power, but justice without power is fucking pointless. And Kaneki is the latter. Beforehand, where he always tried to do the right thing, but he didn't have the power to actually bring forth said right thing. He just couldn't do it. Because he was very hesitant in hurting those that he wanted to inflict his notion of justice upon. A good example would be Mado and Amon when they killed Hinami's mother. Kaneki had power per se, like physical power, but his will and his notions and his views prevented him from using said power. Therefore, he has no power in that position. But now you have the situation where, because he has not taken up a certain path that this ghoul system requires him to take, he has, in essence, put himself in a corner. And his only choice is to break. If he wants to survive, his only choice is to break his previous notions that were established to him by his mom. Take, for example, this. Anteku. Anteku, they're seen as the pussies of the ghoul system. They're bitches. They don't fight. They're pacifists. They're no. Like, we ain't gonna fight. And they're always criticized for not fighting. If you were to consider the fact that there are groups like Aogiri Tree who are more powerful than Anteku from a military standpoint, they would overrun. They would overrun Anteku. Aogiri Tree. So, thing here is this. The old man decides, and that actually ties into that old man's reasoning and logic as well. The old man decides, we're not going to fight. Instead of engaging in power struggles for our survival, we're going to completely isolate ourselves. Not just from other ghouls, but from the doves as well. Because we're not killing humans, we're just consuming humans that have killed themselves. So we're not committing any crimes in this notion. So, when Rize talks about this power structure, and she explains how, because you don't act, because you choose to put all the burden upon yourself, you're in this position. And the burdens will continue to pile on. You have to either make a choice, either you choose path A or you choose path B. But Kaneki opts out of both paths. So even though he's protected from the disadvantages of one path, he doesn't get the advantages of the other path. So in essence, if the right answer is A or B, and you choose C, and C is not an option, or like C is pretty much like opting out, or like, you get my point in that sense. I hope you do. All right, basically, Kaneki, he never puts himself in a position where he has to make choices that break his moral code. Again, he did not engage in combat against Mado and the others when they were taking on Hinami's mom. Could have saved their life if he had the power. So, when you have this from Rize's standpoint, and she's bringing out facts, and she's bringing out future possibilities, and then you have the physical torture, and then you have the mental torture. You break him down slowly. You break him down slowly. And then, boom. You have that final scene, which actually starts off fairly sexual as well. So then you can tie in that whole sexual element to impurity. Because, I mean, for some reason in this day and age, especially considering religious folk, they believe that sexuality is impurity. So, yeah, like, oh, wow. Well, not sexuality, but sex in of itself is impure. Like, you can't have sex unless you're married or some shit like that. If you're a virgin, if you're not a virgin, or if you lost your virginity before marriage, before wedlock, then you're impure. That's why you have born-again virgins. So then you have this initial sexual theme of Kaneki pinning down Rize. And then the purity of the white flower just completely changed into the corrupt red flower. So, again, another aspect of the world, if you would. And it's marvelous. And then when he finally starts to consume her flesh, I have become... No, not become. I am a ghoul. That right there is deep. And it's dope. And I like it. I like the way they did it. I like the way they slowly broke him down. They start from step one. His views are strong. All right? Even though he's being tortured physically, he's still strong. He's still firm. And then you have the choice. These two are going to die if you don't do something. And that's when the first piece of his value starts to break. But keep in mind this. The flowers that were a part of his psyche, they didn't change. Correction. They weren't uprooted. There we go. They weren't uprooted. They weren't removed. They're still there, but they're just corrupt. So if the flowers are corrupt, there is a chance where he can actually purify the flowers. In this case, purify his notions or reinstate his notions once again. Therefore, returning him to the once pure state that he was in before. Very possible. Very possible. Hinami and Toka may be the key for that in the future. But overall, the episode I think is a yo. I think it's that good. I think it's a yo episode, despite the censorship and despite some of the scenes that clearly need to be uncensored. So, the pacing, again, they have a little time for the fight, but I'm okay with that because the fight in itself was phenomenal. So, overall, the episode is going to be yo, and I will see you guys later. So, this is King Lightning. Rate the video, comment, subscribe. Peace. Have a nice day. And, of course, let me know what your thoughts are in this episode. I want to see what your thoughts are because I'm curious. I may have missed some stuff, obviously, because I'm off the cuff, and I don't really do, unless I'm doing like a discussion video, I'm off the cuff. That's just the way it is. So, rate the video, comment, subscribe, peace, have a nice day.